I have for the sake of time. What I'll do is,
instead of going into the details of screening tests and all, let us look at the real life programs. What happens in real life programs of breast cancer screening and colorectal cancer screening? Let us start from here. So what we did this year, we published a huge report. We evaluated the breast, colorectal cancer and cervical cancer screening in 28 European countries. And I'll just present a few this thing. So breast cancer screening. So what European countries they are doing, you can see the recommendation for is 50 to 69 years as the ideal age for breast cancer screening. But still you can see some of the countries they are starting a little earlier. There is reason for that, 45 to 49, because there is some limited evidence that it can work in that age. But then some of the countries are extending it a little too far. So I'll just skip this. I'm not going. Okay. So this was the report. You can get it in the on the online. It is available online. One thing is very sure. Europe has invested a lot to improve their breast cancer screening program. You see, this was 10 years back. Many of the countries were in red. That means they didn't have any program, or they had light blue. That means the program was just starting, rolling out. Now you can see it's almost all the countries, except just a few exceptions, they have deep blue. That means they have completed rolling out of mammography breast cancer screening program. Having said that, now when you look at the actual data from these countries, you see the lot of variabilities. All of them have population-based programs. All of them have mammography-based program, but look at the variability. So this is something called invitation coverage. That means what proportion of the eligible population was invited to screening? Average 80%, good. Some of them are very good, but then look at this. You know, there is all a dip. Though all of them have population-based programs, so it's not that all of them are doing well. So invitation coverage is one of the things that the national program has to monitor on a regular basis. But then that was about invitation. But what happened to actually how many women actually had the screening test? That is called screening coverage. So out of those, out of the total target population, what proportion had screening tests? There you see the variability. Though their programs, they claim that they have completed the coverage, but then you see there is still quite a bit of variability, starting from somewhere around 10 to 20% to about 100%. So this is one important thing which the countries should follow. Participation to screening, that is called participation rate. Okay, if I have invited 100 women to screening, how many of them actually participated? There is something which is called acceptable level. That is 75%. This is the European guideline says that this participation rate should be 75%. Some of the countries, they have exceeded that. Some of the countries are almost there, but majority of the countries have still not reached there. So this makes us to think how complex cancer screening program can be. When we think that Europe has probably one of the best mammography-based cancer screening programs, still within that you see the variability. The further assessment rate, how many women were sent for diagnostic mammography, FNSE or core biopsy. Ideally, acceptable level is 5% of the total women screened should be sent, not more than that. You see, some of the countries are still sending quite a high number of. There are reasons for that. Maybe some of the countries, they are extra cautious. Women with the dense breasts on mammography, they are being sent for further evaluation. So all these things are there. But then you see the variability, though. The good thing is that women having subsequent treatment, it is more or less similar. So in spite of all this, so you can understand there are a lot of false referrals. Though ultimately the women getting treatment is same. So in a real life program, these things happen. detection rates. Look at this is the average detection rate of carcinoma in situ and cancer per 1,000 women. Average European average is 6, but then still there are quite a few countries which are much lower, quite a few countries which are much higher. Why is it so? Detection rate can be dependent on the prevalence of the disease. If there is high prevalence of disease, high incidence of breast cancer, maybe a detection rate of which will be high. It can be because of whether the screening is the first round or subsequent round. Initial round of screening will always have high detection rate, but then it will come down as the women get more and more screening. That can be the reason. Or it can be the quality of pathology. Is the case, especially with carcinoma in situ, are those carcinoma in situs being detected really carcinoma in situ? That's also a question. So that is why carcinoma in situ, the proportion of total cancers detected, what proportion of them is carcinoma in situ, is a very, very important benchmark for quality. And that quality, that should be between 10 to 20%, not more than that. So 10 to 20% of all the cancers detected should be carcinoma in situ. If less, there is a problem. If too high, there is a problem. And you can see in Europe, the problems are there. Some of the countries, they have too high. Some of the countries, they have too low. So that's how the breast cancer screening program is judged. Let me go for what's happening with colorectal cancer screening. I'm just skipping this. Again, lot of investment has been done in colorectal cancer screening in Europe. 10 years back, most of the countries were in red. Some of the countries were just rolling it out. Now, at least you can see some of the countries are deep blue. So Nordic countries, UK, some of the things, they have actually completed rollout of the color of cancer screening program. Though still some of the countries, Germany is a large country which is starting population-based program from this year. So change is happening. And as I said, different tests are being used in different countries. In fact, when we compared the performance of colorectal cancer screening, surprisingly, it was much better as compared to cervical cancer screening. Maybe because cervical cancer screening started in all of these European countries as more as opportunistic program, and then they gradually shifted to population-based program. But the colorectal cancer screening, right from the beginning, they have started a population-based approach. Maybe that is the reason. Here, the recommended age group is 50 to 74 years you can screen. But then, to begin with, many of the countries can start with a narrower age. So that is exactly what they have done. Some of the countries, you can see, they have started between 60 to 70 years of age. And then, depending on your resources, you can go on increasing the range. So that's a lesson from Europe. And so initially, they started with 2-yearly or yearly fit screening. But now UK and Malta, they have they started with 2-yearly FIT screening, but then there are countries, as I said, who are going for colonoscopy or flexible sigmoidoscopy breast screening, which allows them to increase that interval to 5 to 10 years. Now, this is the actual data from the different countries. First thing is, these deep blues are the countries which are having FIT screening. You know, and then the others are the GOFBT, the Guaiac-based test. The FIT immunochemical test is much better than the Guaiac-based test in terms of logistics, because it has to be done once, no restriction of diet, and then probably it is most sensitive than GOFBT. So what we find is the detection rate of the disease, colorectal cancer, we are not including the advanced adenomas. Detection rate of colorectal cancer is better with FIT as compared to GFOBT. But then again, there is quite a bit of variation across the countries. Positive predictive value is very important, especially for colonoscopy, for colorectal cancer screening. Because if we have too many false positives, the next test is very invasive. The colonoscopy, all said and done, at least 1 in 1,000 colonoscopies, there can be either a perforation or a bleeding, a major bleeding. So one has to be careful. So again, positive predictive value, on an average, what we found was about 6 to 7%. And then there is still quite a bit of variability in positive predictive value across the countries. So now these countries, they have to really go into their results, because fit test, it has got cutoffs. Multiple different countries have used different cutoffs. Some countries used 100 microgram as the cutoff, some used 200 microgram as cutoff. So they need to think whether they, to improve their positive predictive value, they need to go for a higher cutoff or not. And so that is just the results. And see, this is what I was talking about, the perforation and the major bleeding after colonoscopy. So again, we go back to the same issue that screening is good if done with an organized population-based approach. It can save lives, it can save resources for the countries, but one should be also thinking about the harms that can be caused by screening. I'll stop here. Thank you very much. And we can take some questions.